Hello, how you doing?
I'm all right.
And what's your name?
Mary Ellison.
And where are we now?
At 163 Stuyvesant.
Hello.
How you doing? What is your name?
Tony Hagler.
And where are we now?
We're in front of 173 Stuyvesant Avenue, Mookie's house.
We're in Bed-Stuy Do or Die on Stuyvesant Avenue between Lexington and Quincy. This is where we shot Do the Right Thing in this one block. Behind us now is a parking lot.
Which was Sal's Pizzeria.
Pizzeria.
My joint that you burned down.
Wait a minute, I didn't burn it down.
Through the goddamn can through the window, which created...
No, see, we're still debating. 26 years later, you we're know, still debating.
Hey!
You said 26 years. It's very hard for me to believe that that much time has expired since
it goes like that, doesn't it? Before we started rolling the cameras, you said, man, I didn't know that this block was this short.
I never realized Quincy was that. I thought this was at least two blocks longer. I never saw that opening. Never saw that, because most of the time it was dark, and I never really looked in that direction, I guess.
Mm-hmm. We needed a block with two empty lots. So on this side of the street, we built Sal's Pizzeria. It was on this empty lot here that we built Sonny's Korean Market. And we had to build the whole facade. It was just a facade, and I built the whole interior of the store.
As soon as the sets were finished, regular people kept wanting to come into the pizzeria and kept wanting to come into the Korean Market.
At that point, I knew that I'd gotten the details right. In this building here, we shot Rosie's apartment was in this building.
I'm Rosie Perez, and I play Tina.
Rosie's apartment was in this building?
That's right, on the top floor.
What's that number on the corner? 172?
Yes, corner. 172.
On the top floor, that was Rosie Perez's apartment.
No, this was Rosie Perez's apartment in 176.
On the top?
Yes.
Tina. So she lived here, huh?
That's right.
Where I live, 176, is where Rosie Perez's apartment was.
Shit's to the curb, Mookie, all right? And I'm tired of it, all right? Because you need to step off with your stupid-ass self, okay? And you need to get a fucking life, Mookie, all right? Because the one you got, baby, is not working, okay? And I ain't gonna deal with this shit no more. This fucking ass, stupid ass, fucking pendejo. Shit, fucking loose fucking shit.
We Love Radio was right here. And the thing about this building is this building was empty. It was an abandoned building. And when it would rain on the set. But Sam spent his whole time in the whole movie inside the radio station.
Never came out.
And it was hot. Place. It was.
We didn't have air conditioning for a minute?
I don't think we. It was bare minimum. It wasn't very much.
Wake up! Wake up, wake up, wake up! Up you wake, up you wake, up you wake, up you wake! This is Mr. Senior Love Daddy, your voice of choice. The world's only 12-hour strong man on the air. Here on We Love Radio, 108 FM. The last on your dial, but first in your heart. And that's the truth, Ruth.
Radio is a character that I live with every day.
Every day?
Every day. Today, I walk out the hotel and immediately do the right thing. You know, that's just something I get every day.
People were stopping me on the street saying, you killed Radio Raheem. I had to change my phone number.
Yeah?
Yeah, I got you're responsible for all the bad shit that's happening in the world.
You know what people ask me, too? Where's your radio? I'm like, did you see the movie?
Love and Hate.
Love and Hate, there it is. That wasn't in the script. There it is, Love and Hate.
Spike was ahead of his time when he wrote, when he made this film. I think he had insight into the whole gentrification thing.
John Savage's character, Clifton, started gentrification.
That's
in
right.
Bever Stuyvesant.
That's right.
Play
that's
with
right.
us. He was the first
26
one.
26 years ago.
Stepping up, stepping up, bugging out Air Jordans.
Yo! You almost knocked me down, man. The word is excuse me.
Excuse me, I'm sorry.
Yo, man, your Jordans are fucked up.
Damn, man. You might as well throw them shits out. Them shits is broke.
I'm out of here.
Oh, then why don't you move back to Massachusetts?
I was born in Brooklyn.
That's when everyone goes.
Younger people rediscover this film or discover it for the first time, and they're like, oh my goodness, that's what I'm going through, that's what's happening in my neighborhood, and it's 25 years ago.
Where's Ruby?
167.
Right here.
There she is.
Danny, that's the window right there.
That's it.
That's right.
Good morning, Mookie.
Good morning, Miss Mother Sister.
Now, Mookie, don't work too hard today. The man says it's gonna be hot as the devil. I don't want you falling out from the heat. You hear me, son?
I hear you, Mother Sister. I hear you.
Good.
All right.
I'll be watching you, son. Mother Sister always watches.
I spoke to Ruby Dee. My mother also spoke to her. She's since passed. And she wanted so badly to meet her, but she was embarrassed to go up. So I took her up and I said, Miss Dee, I said, my mother wants to meet you. And she was so genuine and so kind and just so down to earth. I'll never forget those days.
Me and Ozzy are talking and we're going back and forth and I'm asking him about his life. And then like all of a sudden he just stopped and like looked up to the door and Ruby was doing a play. And he got up and he went and he got her and he brought her over, got her coat, and he laid her coat down on the back of the chair. And he asked if, honey, are you hungry? And in that voice, and she said, yes, I would like something to eat. And he left, and later in the evening, said, Ozzy, man, I've never seen something like that. You know, I'm a young guy, and I've never seen that kind of devotion, that kind of absolute focus on somebody. And I asked him how he did it. And he said, Luis, my friend, it's one day at a time.
This have any meaning to you right here?
I think I was sitting on the stoop when you were burning the plates down. John Turturro, Red Edson, and Ray Edson, and
this
myself.
Is it. You were right here?
And I was looking. I said, they're burning my fucking plate, something like that. You know,
was that emotional, seeing it burn?
Yeah, it was very amazing. You know, I'm an internal guy, you know, so it was. It was a man building something. Wynn would know this far better than I, when he has to strike a set that he's established and made beautiful.
Spikey were actually quite sensitive. He made sure that I wasn't on the set. When he started to burn it.
I didn't know that. That's wonderful.
That's right.
But that's exactly what I meant.
I'm not that sensitive anymore.
But you were. I mean, they made sure I was not here. I was already at home. They were shooting at the night.
Do you remember how we met? Madonna's party.
Yeah.
We're sitting there. You're sitting in this thing, and I'm walking out, and you said, I have a script for you, something like that.
Yeah.
And I wasn't sure who he was. Because, you know, she's got to have it.
Let's keep going with this story.
It's God's truth, but I know who it was.
Let's keep going. You know who I was, so you asked your friends.
Yeah, I asked my friends.
And what did their friends say?
And no, he said, he's hot. He's hot.
No, they said some other things.
Oh, he said he's a Molignon. So you're going to work with a black guy now?
You fucking Molignon, this guy.
He learned the word Molignon from me.
No, I learned from Scorsese, all
Scorsese,
his movies.
Yeah.
I mean, hey, Jake. And we didn't come to fucking Detroit to beat by this fucking Moulin over here, the fucking Mama Luke of the year.
You want to know something? I never used that terminology. But
we're not
a lot
talking
of the people,
about you, Daddy. Yeah. We're not talking about you. That's Scorsese films.
I never did those disguised things with you. Never. You knew more Italian than I did.
I was off the first 2 weeks, and I got to see everything those 2 weeks. But the rest of the time, I would rush home from work just to see what was happening.
The only part, bad part I had about it when I was coming home from work and they would stop me. You can't come through here. And I said, oh, I live on this block.
My window is in the movie because I had a lot of plants and I had one day changed them around and asked, could I please put the plants back the way they were?
But I also wanted to find a block that had very few trees. It's a lot of trees here right now. But 26 years ago,
it was kind of naked.
Very naked. It was just a couple of trees here because, my whole idea is this was like an urban desert. Nobody could get away from the heat.
Right.
Because heat was a very important image that you kept talking about.
This takes place in the hottest day of the summer. We shot in the summer 88.
Yeah.
I said, when people come to theaters in summer 89, and they're watching this in air-conditioned theater, we still want them sweating.
That's right. This is the corner man here. We covered up all these windows. And this is the very famous red wall. It's a really simple use of design, a simple use of color. But I think it spoke so much to what this movie was about.
I really did feel like we were doing something magical, whether or not it was ever going to be something that anybody else thought was going to be magic. You had a vision. You knew that there was an audience out there for it in a way that I don't think anybody else saw.
One of the other things that bonded all of us together and why we still are all friends was the fact that we were there every day. And a lot of people don't know that, right? A lot of people don't know that we were there every day, that we were doing background stuff.
The thing that I remember about this experience is that it was a company.
Yeah.
It was almost like a theatrical experience in the sense that you formed a family.
And it bonded all of us, because we had a lot of time to talk and a lot of time to be around each other.
No one tried to stand out as an individual.
That's right.
It truly was a work of ensemble. And you never got an ego. Did you get ego from anyone in it?
Never.
I don't think there was an ego remark made by anybody. Everyone did his role, her role, and that was basically it, and it all fit.
We had gotten so close because everybody had to work every day. And by the time we got to that scene, if you remember, it was really intense.
The people that were watching seemed to be really, not the actors, but the people that were around, it was scary.
There's
man.
A scene that when Ray Raheem drops to the mat, people started to applaud. No,
really?
Swear to God.
Applaud?
Yes.
White people?
Black people.
Really?
Yes. It was so real.
Wow.
As far as acting goes, that was one of the more real experiences I had. You know, it was as close to real as you want to get, you know.
Dig this.
Here's a story.
He had bottles bouncing off my goddamn head.
No, said, no. No,
that
it wasn't
was a story.
No, it wasn't bottles. Ray Raheem was supposed to drag you along the counter, but not bottles.
No, but that's what I saw. I saw bottles. It reminded me of a cowboy western. And some son of a bitch is sliding me down with bottles bouncing off my head. I said to you, that's comedy time in the Rockies. I'm not doing that shit. That's a deal breaker.
Yeah,
that's
what bottles? Anyway.
No, there weren't bottles.
Randy Fletcher.
I love Randy, man.
First AD.
I love them.
Had to clear the set.
Yes.
Well, we worked it out.
I said, we ain't coming to punches. Look at the size of him. They'd lock my ass up for nothing.
They had it advertised, like, buy a house here, do the right thing. So we'll be.
They
so,
put do the right thing in the advertisement?
Yeah, I can show you the whole advertisement. They got you, do the right thing. This is where Spike made the movie. We're selling condos here, affordable condos. Come see it. Do the right thing and come see it.
I need to get a cut, right?
You sure need to get a cut, because he sold all these units, at least 18 of them. It's a historic block. That's the way I seen him when I moved here.
We're having a block party here Saturday.
It's Radio Raheem coming back to work.
Here we are, June 28th, in the year of our Lord, 2014, and we're on the block where we shot Do the Right Thing. Right now, we've been here since 6 a.m., getting ready for the block party, hanging signs, banners, block, getting the stage right. I want to give a shout out to Beats Music. They made it possible for us to come together and have a good time. We got kids' activities. We're gonna have dope music. People gonna be dancing, having a good time. The weather's great, and we're looking forward to a great day. It's gonna be hot.
Fight the power! 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 Fight the power!
President of the greatest borough in New York City, Eric Adams. Give it up, give it up.
This is how Brooklyn does it, you know what I'm saying? I joined with 40 acres in the Mule Filmworks Incorporation, executives, friends, and supporters to commemorate the 25th anniversary of Spike Lee's film, Do the Right Thing. And I thank Spike for all you have done to help our community forward as one Brooklyn. Do the right thing day in the borough of Brooklyn. Borough President Eric Adams, Spike Lee.
Gentlemen, Eric, if I do, Mos Def, Brooklyn's in the house.
We got another special guest, Mr. Dave Chappelle.
Brooklyn! You guys look beautiful out here. I haven't seen this many black people in 9 years, ladies and gentlemen. It's good to see you. I see a white guy in the middle, too. Hello, sir. My God, Brooklyn has changed. Wesley Snipes is here somewhere.
Come on up, Wes. Come on up, Wes.
Wesley Snipes.
Brooklyn, that's right, New York in the house. Love y'all, love y'all, love you. And give it up for my man, Spizite.
Well, I want to take 2 minutes. I want a moment of silence. Everybody that can hear my voice, put your peace signs up in the air. Because when we leave this block, we got to do the right thing. We got to look out for one another. So on the count of three, I want you to say peace is a lifestyle.
Say y'all's gonna change the name. What we gonna change it to?
Do the Right Thing Way.
Do the Right Thing Way between Lexington and Quincy?
Yeah.
I love that. My new address would be 163 Do the Right Thing Way.
We're honored to have Do the Right Thing Way as the name for our street.
I love the name, Jay. Do the Right Thing Way. I'm waiting for it to be permanent.
I can't believe that Spike put it down like this. I'm the city council person for the 36th Council District, representing Bed-Stuy and Crown Heights. Today, the people of Quincy Street and Bedford-Stuyvesant, the borough of Brooklyn and New York City, continue to proudly claim Spike Lee and Do the Right Thing as their own by co-naming Stuyvesant Avenue between Lewis and Quincy as Do the Right Thing Way.
As promised, a special guest, and they made a special trip to bless us. Let's give it up for Public Enemy!
We can't kill it, bro. We say, what is this?
Of Fight the Power come to you?
You were putting together a film that spoke to all the inequities of the New York City area and asked us to come along and make an anthem for it. We were honored with the task.
Tell us about the track for Fight the Power.
You wanted a theme song.
An anthem.
An anthem theme song that was very powerful. I did the crazy track, played it for Chuck. Chuck came back with it and said, yo, man, I got the anthem for this. And we wanted to make sure that you had the dopest joint on the block.
We had it.
And you had it.
Thank the Lord, the sun is going down. It is hot as blazes. Yes, Jesus. Well, guess I'll be on my way.